My brother and I had always been close growing up. We rarely fought over anything, even as teenagers. My father wasn't around much, so my only father figure in the house was my brother. Since he was 2 years older than me, I idolized him as the man of the house. My brother never married for some reason. I guess you could say he was a bit of an adventurer, but that would be an understatement. He traveled all over the world to exotic locations doing amazing things. Safaris in Africa, base jumping from the top of Sears Tower, and even deep sea diving near the Great Barrier Reef. My brother would tell me of a new adventure every time he visited. Me, on the other hand, I always played it safe, having married my college sweetheart, getting an office job, and having 2 children. While I was more of the cautious type, I had gone skydiving a few times. But I never really could understand why he insisted on putting his life on the line every chance he could. Whenever my brother would visit in September, he would tell me of a new amazing adventure he had. We would all hang on to every word he said. Our lives seemed so boring in comparison. Every time my brother would visit, he would get me to participate in one of his adventures. They usually couldn't even compare to the things he had done. But it was more about him sharing a small part of his life with me. On his last visit, he wanted to go skydiving again. Since I had gone a few times already, I agreed without hesitation. We each loved the view of the changing trees from miles above the earth. It's so serene up there. One could almost forget about all their troubles gently floating above the planet's surface. A first-time jumper can be easily unnerved standing at the door. My brother, ever the professional thrill seeker, had no problem as he fell, waving goodbye to me in freefall. I jumped only a second after him and we met in the air for a high five. The exhilaration of the air violently wiping across our jumpsuits was near deafening, but the beauty of the ground below was more breathtaking than the fall itself. Shades of orange, red, and purple caressed the landscape as though painted on with some magnificent brush. It almost saddens me to have to come back down. As I pulled the cord to the parachute, I realized something was wrong. I wasn't slowing down. I looked up to see my lines tangled together. The parachute itself was half open, causing me to twist and turn in the air. There was no way I could open up my reserve chute with the primary like this. As I pulled on the primary release cord, nothing happened. I began yanking and tugging, but to no avail. My body began turning in a circular motion as my chute fought against gravity. With the ground rapidly approaching, I grabbed my knife from my pocket, but the constant spinning prevented me from positioning my arm to cut the cord. I looked up and saw my brother gracefully descending above me. Just as I reached out to him, I hit the ground. The last thing I heard is a bone-shattering crunch before everything went black. At least, that's what I hope my brother saw as he fell. If only my wife had not left her email open last month. If only her frequent business trips were someplace else other than the places he was. And if only my brother did not insist on sharing everything. Perhaps I would not have tied his chute to the cord. As I sit there sipping my coffee, staring at the changing leaves of fall, my wife lay in our bed gasping for air from the gaping gash in her neck. And I can't help but think to myself, my, what a beautiful fall. The thing about shapeshifters is that they are easy to spot if you pay attention. Being mere copycats of the form they inhabit, they always get something wrong. It may be a small detail, but to the observant, it's obvious. A mole is forgotten, a pierced body part overlooked. No matter how good they are, something is always forgotten. That's why when he stumbled through the door a few hours later than normal, I knew he was not who he seemed to be. Gloria perked right up though, squealing as she ran to his legs. Something inside of me told me to grab her and remove her from this monster pretending to be our father. Yet I was so sure that if I moved to get her, he would know his disguise had not worked and begin devouring the family early, I needed time to deal with this, so I did nothing as she squeezed his calf with her tiny arms. Though I hate to admit it, this one's acting was pretty good. He quickly leaned down and picked up the giggling 3-year-old and kissed her on the head. Nothing seemed amiss to her. You know what they say about ignorance. From the kitchen, my mother asked where he had been. She had been worried about him. But sometimes he has come home late from work before. Dinner did not make itself, so she had busied herself with it to keep her mind off her husband. Just business with a new client. His voice was the exact same one I had heard this morning before he left for work. This one, though, he almost got everything right. I had to admit, I admired the attention to detail. Some of them were just so lazy. The salt and pepper black hair. A day's worth of stubble on the chin. Hell, they even included the odd scarring on his right ear from where an earring in his youth had been torn out. But as always, one detail is off. His eyes. This morning they had been a piercing blue but were now a dull gray. I doubted anyone else in the family would catch on before this creature managed to devour them all. This one must have known the eyes were the defect as he was careful not to look directly at anybody. I myself had to catch a few glimpses of his face to notice. My mother called me to dinner and told me to take my hat off. She did not come into the room but raised her voice just loud enough for all of us in the room to hear. A clatter of plates and other cutlery was slightly muffled as she set the table. Okay, Mom. I took off the baseball cap and ran my hand through my brown hair. It had become ruffled from the cap I had been wearing for a few days. Dinner was uneventful, but the creature pretending to be the family man did not eat anything.
Sorry, I figured I'd be working late, so I just ate at work, was his excuse.
Good one. He busied himself looking at his papers and kept any talk to a minimum. My mom frowned at me before saying, "Eat your food," as she cleaned Gloria of the mess she had made with her dinner. Sorry, Mom, I muttered, pushing the food around. I was hungry, but how could I eat while I was distracted by the creature stealing furtive glances at Gloria from behind his papers? He wanted her first. I just knew it. So young, so tender. Who could ever pass up a meal like that? It was at that moment I knew. I had to act first. The question was how. How indeed. After dinner, Gloria was put to bed. Mom reading her a story before she would leave her for the night. I was in charge of the dishes, but I left them to check on the creature parading around in the skin of my father. The creature had taken up residence in the study, stating before he left the table that he had more work to do before bed. Just another excuse, I'm sure. He would most likely wait until everyone was asleep, and then slip into Gloria's room and devour her before she could even scream. Then he would make his way into each of our rooms. I shook my head. This one must be relatively young. The older ones know to settle into the family before you ate them all. Makes it easier to catch them off guard. I was sneaking up to the door when I heard him call for me.
Jordan, can you come here for a minute? I want to show you something.
You could almost hear him salivating as he schemed about how he was going to eat all of us. Perhaps he had noticed me staring at him. Or maybe he was more perceptive than I had given him credit for. Eat the one that doesn't trust you first. I have to admit, it's a smart move. Sure thing, Dad. I grinned. I knew it was a trap for sure, but I would let him lure me in. At this point, there was no doubt in my mind that this thing was a shapeshifter. No doubt at all. After all, if this really was the man he was supposed to be, wouldn't he have noticed that this kid's hair was supposed to be black instead of brown? I used to work the graveyard shift at a Dunkin' Donuts. For those of you who don't know what a Dunkin' Donuts is, it's basically a donut chain that sells coffee, breakfast items, and of course, donuts. It didn't always used to have a night shift, though. Originally, my location had regular hours with regular customers throughout the day. Overall, it was a simple job. Make sure everything was stocked, clean, and make sure the coffee was fresh. Pretty much the only downside, apart from working the morning shift, was dealing with the ungrateful customers. Most of the time, it was a rushed businessman who didn't have time to wait 5 minutes for a simple cup of coffee. Or an entitled soccer mom who would lose her mind on us over a piece of cheese on a sandwich which she didn't want. After working in the food industry for a few months, I had acquired a newfound respect for the people who work in this industry. Everyone is just trying their best. And yes, mistakes do happen, but almost every time, mistakes can and do get fixed on the spot. I've had my share of hostile interactions from customers too. One time, during my first week of working there, I accidentally dropped a cup of coffee while handing it to a customer. Luckily, it didn't spill on them. It slipped and fell to the ground, out of the way. Watching that cup fall from my hands was like slow motion. The guy who I was handing the cup to was actually very polite and laughed it off. Whereas his girlfriend was livid. She actually threatened to drag me out back and boil me in hot coffee just to see how I'd like it. It was a good thing my manager was there and saw the whole thing. He apologized profusely to the couple and gave them complimentary coffee and sandwiches. Suffice to say, I never dropped another cup after that. Another incident that happened was when a woman ordered a cup of coffee. She quickly took a drink from it and then immediately threw the coffee back at me. She said it was far too hot and that we were trying to kill her. It was a good thing I was wearing an apron or else I'd have a whole different set of problems. This brings me to a little over a month ago when our location was recently selected to become 24 hours. A lot of other establishments would maintain a 24-hour drive-through window, but ours was fully open. I'll be honest, it was interesting to see the new types of customers who would come in during these hours. We of course had the hipsters and goths who had nothing better to do at 3 a.m. than to sit in a coffee shop drinking one cup for an hour. There were the occasional overworked businessmen and interns, trying desperately to finish that last-minute presentation. We'd get the graveyard shift workers stopping in to get their much-needed caffeine fix. And once in a while, a husband or boyfriend who had got thrown into the doghouse would show up. When we were notified of this new schedule, we were initially asked to volunteer for the graveyard shift. I knew it would take some getting used to, but in my mind, the minimal workload would be worth it. So I immediately offered to take the night shift. Everything was going well for the first 2 weeks or so. The customers I told you about earlier had started becoming a part of my nightly routine. The best part about working the night shift is that almost everyone was either too tired or too apathetic to be rude or hostile towards us. I think the biggest gripe we got was from a hipster asking if we had any 100% grass-fed organic sugarcane. To which I responded to him that this was a Dunkin' Donuts. He just huffed as he stared into his cup and then walked away. A couple weeks ago, I had encountered a new type of customer, though he is very difficult to describe. Have you ever met someone that makes you nervous for some unknown reason? Well, at around 2:30 a.m., a man walked in with a large overcoat, with a collar pulled up, and a black beanie on his head. What struck me as odd first was the lack of people in our lobby. Normally, at this time, we'd have the goths huddled in the corner cursing the system or something. But the entire store was empty aside from this man, myself, and my manager who was in the back, probably sleeping or something. After this person walked in, I thought it had to be a homeless man, trying to escape the cold and possibly seek out a hot cup of pity. But then I saw his face. He was somewhat gaunt, but cleanly shaven. His eyes had dark circles around them as if he were tired, but he seemed quite energized. He then walked up to the counter. At that moment, I realized how tall this guy was. Like Kobe tall. I asked him what he would like to order. He just stared straight ahead as if he were zoning out. I repeated my question a bit louder. He only said one word.
Coffee.
His voice was harsh and grating. Like he had been screaming recently. Not wanting to risk more awkwardness, I didn't ask him about any flavors or sizes. I quickly grabbed a fresh cup of black coffee and set it in front of him. The man then leaned down and looked me in the eye, and asked me if I was alone. I told him I wasn't, that my manager was in the back room. He then pulled out a few crumpled up dollar bills, handed it to me, and then walked back out of the door without taking his coffee with him. As soon as he left the building, I felt this intense atmosphere lift up from around me. I was at a loss for words, to be honest. I quickly rushed to the back and told my manager about the whole situation, to which he told me to put the man's money aside in case he comes back for it. The next night, everything was back to normal. The usual customers sat in their respective seats, sipping their coffee. While I was keeping myself busy and mopping the floor, I couldn't help but think about the interaction I had last night. That's when I happened to look out of our front window. And I saw him. He was standing across the street under a streetlight. He was just standing there, staring at me. I turned to see if my manager was behind the counter, and when I looked back, he was gone. At that point, I was starting to feel unnerved. But it wasn't until the following night that I became downright terrified. I was busy stocking some shelves in the back when I heard the front doorbell ring. I quickly rushed out of the back, but I stopped in my tracks when I saw the man standing in front of me. He looked terrible. His previously shaven face was covered in patchy stubble. His cheeks looked much thinner than last time, and his eyes looked lifeless. I asked the man if he was all right, but he didn't reply. He just stood there in the lobby staring at me once again. I told him I was going to call the police so they could come help him. As soon as I grabbed the phone from the counter, the man charged at me. He grabbed me by the throat and threw me to the ground. After hearing the commotion, my manager burst from the back room and demanded an explanation. In a panic, I told him to call the police, but it was only then I realized the man who had grabbed me had disappeared. I called out of work for the next 2 nights. I just needed some time to recover from that whole encounter. I still probably should have had my manager call the police the other night, but reasoned in my head that the guy was probably long gone. My last night working there was the worst by far. And also the reason I quit. I had arrived to work and relieved the people working before me. That's when I received a call from my manager telling me that he had a family emergency and would be a few hours late. I was upset, but there wasn't much I could do, so I just said alright. After 3 uneventful hours of me cleaning the same racks over and over again to keep my mind off things, I glanced out of the window once more. What I saw made my blood turn to ice. The man was standing on the other side of the window. He was grinning at me with a sinister smile that caused my body to seize up. Right away, I pulled out my cell phone and called the police. While my phone was ringing, the man did something strange. Without peeling his eyes from the glass, he pulled out a cell phone from his pocket. I watched him carefully as he began to type something into the phone without even looking at it. At that moment, my phone buzzed, notifying me of a text. The message said, "Now you're alone." It was then I noticed that the text came from my manager's phone. Immediately, I ran into the back office and locked the door. At that point, the dispatch operator had answered and I told him about my current situation. As I spoke to them, I could hear the front doorbell ring. I could hear heavy footsteps walking into the back area. The operator told me that 2 police cars were already on their way. The man began pounding on the door, trying to break it down. I screamed from the other side that I called the police and that they were almost here. Then the banging stopped. The police arrived a few minutes later but found no traces of the man and took my statement. They asked me where my manager was and I told them I had no idea, but that I thought the guy had done something to him. The police escorted me home and told me they would keep in touch. A week or so had passed, I never went back to work and I never saw the man again. I did receive a call from one of the officers, however. He told me that they found my manager's car in a ditch on some back road, but he was nowhere to be found. He also told me that the security footage we had in the store had somehow been corrupted and was now unusable. I don't know who or what that thing was, or why it targeted me. But I know one thing for sure. I'm never working the graveyard shift anywhere. Ever again. I had managed to keep a healthy skepticism of ghosts, ghouls, and all things supernatural until I was 28. I found most claims of such things to be dubious at best and harmful at worst. I was very much in the camp of the classical sciences as I had studied physics at college several years earlier. While my profession has never taken me back into the scientific arena, I had, until this time, maintained a ruthless opposition to pseudoscience and superstition. My friends often wonder about the change they saw in me at the time. What surprised them was that it wasn't a slow, steady change of heart, but rather a complete turnaround overnight. A transformation, if you will. It may have appeared as if it occurred so very quickly, but in fact, it happened over a slightly longer timescale, 2 weeks to be precise. It was February. In fact, it was the week of Valentine's Day. Around this time, I was going through a socially isolated phase. It's something which often happens in the bleak winters, where I become increasingly wrapped up in my own loneliness and passing bitterness at those who fit in. It was and still is a neurotic hangover from my teenage years, one which has plagued me for far too long. 2 weeks earlier, I had found myself wandering through the city streets to clear my head. Walking, as amusing as it may seem, has always been a great comfort to me. You are, in every sense, alone with your thoughts. But that part of you which craves the company of others is slightly appeased by being in the world, even if you're only in it long enough to share a glance with a passing stranger. My city is an old one, and has remarkably kept much of its former self. The old streets break off sporadically into narrow lanes which occasionally open up into secluded courtyards. These numerous courtyards are often flanked on all sides by tall terraced houses, huddling together as if whispering a secret and a long forgotten past. The impressiveness of the city is often lost on those who have lived here long enough to find beauty commonplace. As it often happens when gripped by depression, I hadn't been sleeping well. I had finished work the previous evening around 5 p.m. and while I managed to get a few hours of sleep, my mind just wouldn't let me relax. Come 6 in the morning, even though it was a Sunday and I could for once sleep in, I conceded defeat in my attempts to have a proper rest and got up to greet the world, however reluctantly. By the time I had set out, it was still early morning and the cold January air stung my face. Although my city is, for want of a better expression, a tourist city, at that time it still seemed relatively deserted, even for a Sunday. A slight mist had risen out of the water from the nearby lake, making it feel all the more colder as I passed through the narrow lanes and down empty pavements, entirely oblivious to where I was going. As the shops opened and the first trickle of tourists bled out onto the walkways from their hotels, I deliberately headed for a quieter, often forgotten network of streets. My wandering mind had indeed taken over, for as I broke through the haze of a daydream, I found myself standing at the gates of an old graveyard. I had been thinking of turning back and heading home, but something about this place awoke a compulsion in me. I had to explore it. I found it curious that the gates, constructed out of blackened steel rods, were lying unlocked as early in the day as this. Entering the cemetery, I immediately noticed the overall isolation of the place, enjoying the sound of gravel under my feet which pierced the silence as I moved slowly along a path littered with small white stones. It wasn't a terribly large graveyard. It seemed to consist of two separate plots, with the older graves at the front, bordering the fence and gate, filing backwards up onto a diminutive hill where the more recently deceased residents lay. The oldest graves bore the weathered scars of age. I found one which was dated 1776. Sadly, the epitaph was illegible. I felt a sadness staring at the headstone, wondering who it belonged to and indulgently contemplating about myself as a forgotten or lost soul. Eventually, I moved off, wandering up the hill towards the newer graves. I found myself drawn to a large old sycamore tree which loomed over several graves below it. with an almost protective demeanor. I stared at one of the headstones, reading the words but not registering them, as my mind was engulfed by yet another daydream. The grave itself stood out somewhat from those around it. The headstone itself was white in color, while those which accompanied it were forged out of a deep, black marble. Without thinking, I ran my hand over the smooth stone, feeling the occasional mark of the elements upon it. At the foot of the headstone lay a small, innocuous vase. It was made of a brownish metal, copper, I assumed, as the surface exhibited small veins which were blue in color due to its exposure to the weather. As I stood there, something rose up out of my mind, something which bothered me greatly. At first, I did not know what it was, experiencing it merely as a low, growing sense of discomfort. As this feeling of unease reached a crescendo, I suddenly realized what was wrong. The name upon the grave was Lisa Main. I knew that name well. Everyone in the local area did. I had known her when I was growing up, as we went to the same school together. She was someone that I watched from afar, full of life and exuberance, while I was shy, reclusive, and reserved. I possessed that intense infatuation and desire for her, one which only a first love can produce. The words on her headstone came into sharp focus. Age 15. I was overcome with a tremendous sense of grief and loss, one which took me entirely by surprise, so much so that I had to leave that place. I just couldn't bear it. As someone who prides himself on being level-headed and immune to flights of fancy, I could not shake the profound unease which often comes with outrageous coincidence. I exited the graveyard as quickly as possible and headed home, ignoring the now cluttered streets of the city. I did not look back. I didn't want to. Over the following few days or so, I was preoccupied. I was overworked and was having trouble sleeping, but that was not unusual for me. What was unusual were the immovable thoughts and memories of Lisa Main, thoughts which now stayed with me wherever I would go. I had been terribly affected by her death, as we were only 15 years old at the time. But that was well over a decade ago, and I had not thought of her for many, many years. It was as if seeing that gravestone had awoken a sense of loss, a sense of pain, which I had managed to bury so far deep inside of me. A cacophony of memories now haunted me, beautiful and terrifying. At any one moment, I would be exhilarated by the thought of her smile, her hair, her kindness. And, at the very next, engulfed by despair at the image of her lying under 6 feet of earth, cold and alone, once full of life, now a decaying husk, which had long ago housed that beautiful soul. If I had told anyone how I felt, they would have called me overly emotional or sentimental. For the fact remained, I barely knew Lisa. Watching her for years across a classroom, I imagined myself talking with her, sharing those intoxicating moments which mean so much to a teenager. The first connection with someone you adore, the first feeling of being loved, the first kiss. I had, in fact, hardly ever spoken to her until only a few weeks before she died. In one of those embarrassing maneuvers which teachers often pull, the pupils were all forcefully partnered with someone to take our first social dance. Social dancing was a torrid affair. For someone like Lisa, it was fun and to be enjoyed, while for me, it was something to be detested. I was embarrassed, possessing none of the talent to be a dancer, and even more so afraid to spend time with a girl, held back by my own teenage awkwardness. It was the end of January, and Lisa quickly set me at ease in social dancing class where we practiced. I cannot convey the simultaneous sense of joy and fear which I felt when she asked me to walk her home that day. Some people find social interactions to be exhausting, much like myself, always worried about saying the wrong thing, but some individuals can set others at ease with the smallest of effort. Lisa was one of those people. As we walked across a bridge toward her house, the winter sun bathed our surroundings in a cool, comforting glow. I couldn't have been more content to be in the presence of this happy, kind-hearted girl. She was so beautiful, with an incredible smile, and golden locks of hair which seemed more at home in a fairy tale than in our surroundings. For weeks, we walked the same route home every day, talking, laughing, something I rarely did, and growing ever closer. When you are that age, everything is so potent. Most can fall in and out of love in a heartbeat. I didn't have many friends, and I lived alone with my mother, who is not a particularly affectionate woman. So in that short time, I fell in love with Lisa Main. On the 13th of February, we stopped outside her house. We stood talking for a moment, and then for the first time, Lisa became distant. She stared straight at me in a way that she had never done before. I felt uneasy, yet exhilarated. There was a moment, a tiny moment where we said nothing to one another. Then she hugged me. Her fingers slid through my hair. I will never forget how sweet she smelled, how alive she felt, and how grateful I was to someone for showing me a kindness I had never previously known. Lisa slowly let go of me and then skipped up to her front door. Just before she disappeared, she turned and smiled at me one last time. Then she was gone. Immediately, I knew what I was going to do. For the first time in my life, I was full of purpose and focus, a desire to do just one thing. I ran as fast as I could to the local shops. I was lucky, as most of them were shutting up for the day. A kind old man who ran a rarely used card store allowed me into his shop, even though he was just closing. I was going to buy my very first Valentine's card. It had to be perfect. It had to be just right. After looking at almost every card I could afford, I found one. It was fate. The card was red with a white circle in the middle. In that circle was a boy and a girl walking hand in hand into the distance, together. I did not care what it said, because I have always had a way with the written word, and I knew I could put something down which came from the heart. So I bought it. After leaving the card shop, I went straight to a local convenience store. I had kept aside my last $2. My mother gave me an allowance to buy my lunch at school, and I knew she would not give me any more should I spend it, despite it meaning I would have to go without lunch for a few days. I bought a box of chocolates to accompany the card. I rushed home, walked straight past my mother, who barely greeted me, grabbed a pair of scissors from the kitchen and headed upstairs. I knew I would get into an unbelievable amount of trouble for it, but I didn't care. I cut a slither of material from the red curtains hanging in my mother's room and tied a makeshift ribbon around the box of chocolates. In my mind, it now looked like a Valentine's gift. I wrote in the card explaining how I felt about Lisa and how much those walks home had meant to me, signed it, sealed the envelope, and slid it under the ribbon so it sat nicely with the chocolates. I waited for the next day. It came all too slowly. The 14th of February. I will never forget the excitement of getting ready for school. I took one last look at the chocolates and card before slipping them into my bag. I think I made it a little too obvious that I was carrying something important and delicate, as I cradled the whole bag in my arms for most of the day. I was so enthused, so focused that I was going to march straight up to Lisa and give her the gift without a care for what the others, some of whom could be very cruel, would think. But she wasn't there. She wasn't at her locker. She wasn't in her classes. For the subjects we shared, I just sat and stared at her empty desk and chair. School finished, and I found myself walking the same route Lisa and I would normally take. I stood outside her house, holding the chocolates. I can't describe the feeling I experienced there. Call it the effects of a lack of food or the exhaustion of having been so primed for the day. But anxiety took me, and as a result, I couldn't bring myself to knock on her door. So I went home, dejected. I couldn't even bring myself to eat a bite of the undercooked ham my mother threw down in front of me. So I simply went upstairs and crawled into bed, barely sleeping all night. For the next 2 days, I walked that same route and found myself holding on to those chocolates, not daring to cross the threshold of the little white fence in front of Lisa's house. On the third day, I asked our teachers about Lisa's absence, something which just hadn't occurred to me to do. I associated any authority with being cold, distant, and unfair, and, as a result, normally avoided contact with my teachers at any cost. Mr. Randall, our history teacher, told me that Lisa had come down with a bad fever and was very ill, that she could be away for weeks. With this news, I was resolute. I was going to knock on her door, and knock on her door was what I just did. I knocked, and knocked, and knocked, but no one answered. The next day I did the same, and again no one answered. It had now been 5 days since I had last seen Lisa. It was a Saturday, and once again, I went over to Lisa's house, chocolates and card in hand. As I approached her house, the sky clouded over, casting a dull hue over Lisa's seemingly deserted street. It was clear to see that Lisa's father was not a gardener. The garden path split an overgrown and patchy lawn in two, with clamoring weeds stretching up towards the sun through numerous cracks in the concrete slabs. I stopped to look around and focus my gaze on what seemed to be a smallish gnome figurine, smothered in the undergrowth. It had sadly been broken. Many suggest that when something is wrong, a person knows. They may not be aware of precisely what has happened, but they can almost feel a palpable sense of dread in the air. I looked around and continued towards the front door. Something was different. I was sure that the house had seemed as deserted as it had on the previous days I had visited. And while the house was for all intents and purposes exactly the same as before, there was one change. The front door was open. I was convinced that it had been shut when I had arrived. But I dismissed this as simply the byproduct of my fascination with the condition of Lisa's garden. You see, I can't quite explain it, but there was something suffocating about that house on that quiet street. I reached the door and grasped onto the door knocker, knocking it 3 times. No answer. I repeated my knocks more forcefully this time, but still no one came. The door was only slightly ajar, and as such, I couldn't really see much of the interior. All I could tell was that the house was dark, and that the air escaping through the doorway was musty, as if nothing had stirred inside for days. I started to feel nervous. I didn't really know why. Clearing my throat and stammering slightly, I asked, "Hello?" several times without answer. The street was empty, and the whole place felt devoid of life. Then a thought began to ruminate and gather momentum within me. What if Lisa and her father were hurt? I started to play out all the possibilities in my mind. The two of them lying somewhere in the house injured without food or water for days. Then I remembered that my history teacher had said that Lisa was sick. He must have spoken to someone to know this, probably Lisa's father. I hoped that she was not so sick that her father had to take her to the hospital. Despite the logic of my thoughts, I could still not dismiss the horrible feeling that something was indeed wrong. Fear began to grip me. Yet I closed my eyes only for a moment and found the memory of Lisa's embrace all the solace that I needed to overcome it. I held on tightly to the card and chocolates as I pushed the door forcefully open. It moved silently. The house was bathed in darkness. I took one last look around me and crossed the threshold. While Lisa did not come from an affluent family, the house had an upstairs and must have had at least 4 bedrooms with an attic. Perhaps the fact that Lisa was an only child made the house seem all the more larger or emptier. But as I slowly made my way down the hallway, I felt as if each footstep echoed throughout distant passages and rooms. Beginning with the living room on the ground floor, I moved from room to room, occasionally asking if anyone could hear me. But I quickly became aware that I was only talking to myself. The air was stifling hot, and running my hand across the radiator, I realized that the boiler must have been on for some time. As I moved into the kitchen at the rear of the house, I heard something. It was an almost rhythmic, dull thudding. I couldn't identify what it was, but I knew it was coming from somewhere upstairs. I left the kitchen, which I was glad to do so as it was filled with the smell of rotting food, and walked to the foot of the stairs. The staircase was quite narrow and ran along the inside of a wall. At the top of the stairs was a landing which curved around to the left and led onto the other rooms. The dull thudding was now more pronounced, and as I slowly climbed the stairs, the same fear which had gripped me at the door returned. The realization of wandering into someone's house uninvited came to the forefront of my mind. Stopping for only a moment, I closed my eyes and thought of Lisa again. Then I continued on. As I reached the top of the stairs, the thudding noise stopped. I shudder now even just thinking about it. There were three doors leading to other bedrooms and one leading to a bathroom which I could already see was empty. The door to the first bedroom lay open. I peered in slowly, almost expecting to find someone there. There was no one. It was Lisa's father's room. Neat. Organized. With almost no objects of any note. The only curiosity was that the curtains were not drawn. The door to the second room was closed. Again, I was overcome with a sense of intrusion. I was walking around inside someone's house without an invitation. In effect, I was a trespasser. I knocked on the door quietly, waiting for a moment. I realized the room must be empty, and turned the brass handle on the door. It opened. As I pushed the door, it creaked and then suddenly stopped after only a few inches of movement. Something was behind the door. I pulled it towards me and then pushed again, but no luck. With each attempt, the wooden door bashed off of something. I suddenly became aware of the noise I was making as each attempt echoed throughout the house. It was not dissimilar to the thudding I had heard before. I tried one more time, pushing against the obstacle as hard as I could. No luck. I was about to give up and move on to the next door when I saw what was blocking my entrance. I will never forget the cold, glassy stare of the face, which seemed to be peeking out from behind the bottom of the door. The skin a pallid gray, a few retreating locks of hair covering an otherwise balding head, globules of sweat congealed under. Most of its features were obscured by the door, but the only visible eye still stared, clouded and covered in shadow. I didn't scream, because I quickly realized that not only was this the face of Lisa's father, but that he was very much dead. I felt numb. But looking back, I realized I handled the situation much more calmly than many of my age would have. But then I did have a strange fascination for such things, reading many accounts of quite horrific death scenes. I stared for a moment, composed myself, and then instantly turned to thoughts of Lisa and where she might be. Was she in the same room? Was she in the attic? All I could hope for was that she was okay. Then something happened. An event which I have to this day repressed, ignored, and avoided as much as I possibly could. Something which shook me to the core. Something which I have never told a soul about. The face, staring up at me through that gloom-filled gap in the doorway, moved. At first, it was only slight, and I disregarded it as the effect of shock. Then it moved again. Suddenly, the door began to shake violently as if being punched and kicked by the body lying behind it. The head turned upwards as the cracking of rigor mortis from the neck struggled against each sharp and vicious movement. A putrid, gurgling sound gasped out, enraged from deep within its bloated throat. I closed my eyes. I was sure it was not real. The banging stopped, and the house once again fell into silence. I let out a sigh of relief and opened my eyes. What I saw, I can barely describe now. The face had moved upwards from behind the door to be level with mine. The door shook and rattled under the strain as its venomous attacker tried to claw and batter its way through. Finally, the face pushed and squeezed through the gap of the door, revealing its repulsively loathsome features in their entirety. Dead. Swollen with clotted blood. Gasping relentlessly for air. All the time staring straight at me, through hate-filled eyes with lips pulled back over teeth gritted together, grinding against one another in wretched hatred. I don't remember much of what took place after that. Perhaps I am glad to. I know I escaped, and I know that I ran home confused, crying and babbling like a madman. I also know one more thing. While the memory has been pushed so deep inside that I can barely recognize it, I know whatever was in that room slipped through the gap in that doorway and grabbed me. How I escaped, I don't know. The truth was more horrifying than I could have imagined. Lisa's father had lost his job a couple weeks earlier, and as bills mounted, combined with the pressures of looking after his only child, he snapped. When the police entered the house, they found poor, sweet Lisa's body in the cellar. Her wrists were tied to a radiator. She had been strangled to death. After killing his daughter, Lisa's father had then went upstairs and hung himself in her room. After a few days of hanging there, the cord he used to choke the life from himself seemed to have snapped. The police found his body slumped behind the bedroom door. The door was open. As time eroded the memory, the explanation of these events altered greatly. Through my years of study at school and then college, I read of psychological pressures and how trauma could bring about vivid hallucinations. I had convinced myself that I had found Lisa's father dead, and that the shock had produced the rest of the experience. No matter how real it felt, the idea that a corpse twisted by rage and hate, perhaps even by the love I felt for his daughter, could somehow come back to life and attack the living, just did not fit with my scientific and atheistic understanding of the world. I dismissed the entire experience, but one thing had still managed to haunt me, until I managed to hide it from myself. The police reported that Lisa had been tied up for a couple of days before she was killed. The date of her death was recorded as the 15th of February. She had been in that cellar, tied up, frightened but alive, when I had come by to give her Valentine's gift. People talk about hauntings and spirits, but the memory of that contorted face rising up through the doorway was nothing compared to the knowledge that had I went into her house that day, that maybe, just maybe, I could have saved her life. Yes, I was a child, but I could have done something. So I grew up. But I never felt that love again, that feeling of connection with another human being. I developed an unhealthy attachment to my own company and found myself more interested in burying my head in textbooks than perhaps meeting others, or maybe even falling in love. The friends that I did have were never that close to me, nor did they ever truly understand who I was. Seeing Lisa's grave had brought it all flooding back to me. Those stolen moments. That creature in the house. Her death. The funny thing is that all of those memories, both traumatic and precious. The one thought which would not leave me was of the Valentine's gift I never gave. While I still hope that the dead thing in Lisa's house was of my own imagination, and that the world was still very much material, lacking in the spiritual, I still felt the need to rectify this. I had kept the card all those years. In many ways, it was both my most cherished and loathed possession. Cherished for the memories which it drew up within me, and loathed for the same reason. On the morning of the 14th, I walked through the streets of the city towards Lisa's resting place. On the way, I had stopped at a corner store and picked up a box of chocolates. On my first visit, I had wandered there by accident, vaguely negotiating each street in a daze. But this time I was focused and resolute. Sentiment is a curious thing, and it had encouraged me to keep not only the card, but also the ribbon I made for the chocolates. When I entered the graveyard, I gazed up towards that lonely hill where she lay. I felt hesitant, not because I did not want to leave the gifts by her graveside, but more so because I did not know the extent to which the feelings of remorse, sadness, and bitter nostalgia would overcome me again. Nevertheless, I took a moment and then made my way up over the whitened path, up towards the hill, up towards her. There I stood. The sun was still relatively low in the sky, and it cast long, contorted, and exaggerated shadows over everything. After standing there for what seemed like an age, I pulled out the ribbon, tied it carefully around the box, and then placed the chocolates and the card against the cold headstone. I don't know if I said anything. At the time, I probably didn't, as I was still convinced that she wasn't there to hear me, that once your loved ones pass away, they're gone forever, that death is the end. I do know that I cried. I cried like I hadn't since I was a child. I fell to my knees and buried my head in my hands. I was inconsolable. Those moments of utter sadness, utter despair at the cruelness of life and what it had done to beautiful Lisa, were the last I had as a true skeptic. For as I knelt there, the wind blew gently through the graveyard, gently caressing those stone markers of loss and those who attended them. I had heard and read about people having a religious or spiritual experience, and while I cannot truly accept others' testimonies, I can say that what I felt at that moment was profound, an achingly beautiful feeling of companionship and love. I looked around. No one was there, but I felt that someone was. I tried to shake the feeling off as my mind simply playing tricks on me, but no matter how much I tried to stick to that interpretation of events, I simply couldn't do it. That feeling shared a twin emotion. I had only once ever felt that way before, when Lisa hugged me the last time I saw her. As the sensation washed over me, I realized that I had truly been searching for that same feeling again, but I've been unable to find it until that moment. I stood up, wiped my eyes, and touched the gravestone as if to say goodbye. I walked to the graveyard entrance with a smile which stretched from ear to ear. Something anyone who knows me will tell you is extremely unusual. When I reached the gate, I glanced once more at the hill, which for me was no longer a site of loneliness, but one of love and friendship. The second and last time I can say I have ever seen a ghost was at that moment. For standing up on that hill, beside Lisa's grave, was the blurry image of a young girl in a pink social dancing dress. I didn't run to the grave, because I knew I didn't have to. She waved slowly at me, and then disappeared behind her headstone. I walked home. I felt full, joyful, and exuberant. It is almost impossible to describe that experience by the graveside. Perhaps completeness will do for now, but even that cannot convey it. Friends wonder what happened to me around that time. The truth is, I found something I did not know was missing. Some of you listening to this may think that I found my faith, but it was not that at all. What I found that day was companionship and acceptance from the only person I had ever truly loved. I knew from that day onwards that the world was a far more mysterious and wonderful place than I could have ever possibly imagined. I knew that I would never fear being alone, for when I go wandering through the streets of my city and I find myself on a quiet stretch of road, I smile to myself knowing that if I listen carefully, I can hear the footsteps of Lisa, that girl I loved so dearly when I was a child, walking with me wherever I go. I hate my brother. When I was 4, I asked for a brother or sister for Christmas one year. Mom and Dad had said no, it didn't work that way. They said that I was to be their only special little guy. But then, 2 years later, they changed their minds. And so did I. I remember when Mom told me. We sat alone in my room and she cried, telling me how much she loved me, but that soon, I would have a little brother. I was so furious. I couldn't even speak. I began throwing my toys. My mom screamed, begging me to stop, until a plastic truck I hurled hit her in the head so hard it split her forehead open. She ran from my room, bawling her eyes out. I sat in my room alone, seething, the rest of the night. It felt like after that conversation, my parents couldn't care less about me. Mom and Dad prepared for my little brother's arrival. I watched, silently, hatefully, from the corner of what used to be my nursery, as they prepared it for the new arrival. When they weren't looking, I would undo their work. I tore the wallpaper down. I snapped bars off the crib. But everything I did, they just repaired it. They cried. They held each other. But they went on with their plans for my brother. I was enraged. Right before he was born, my dad came into my room, sat down, and begged me to give him a chance, to welcome him into the family. But, just like before, my anger overtook me. However, unlike Mom, Dad appeared less scared and more sad as I raged, hurling toys, eventually even breaking a window. As my tantrum subsided, he sighed, stood up, and left the room. Something bothered me about the way he looked at me when he turned back for the briefest of moments, just before he closed the door behind him. I sat on my bed all afternoon, furious. Hours later, still angry, I heard voices downstairs. Curious, I left my room. I saw Mom and Dad in the living room, talking to a man dressed all in black. I noticed something funny around his neck, something white. I couldn't really quite understand what they were talking about. What's an exorcism?
Unto the world was born a three-eyed angel, with one eye that could see the past, one eye that could see the present, and one eye that could see the future. On the first day, locals assembled to watch the angel open his eye to the past. He saw all of the horrors we had endured and caused. The bloodshed, the murders, the gas showers, the pointless abuse, and the centuries of strife. He shed a single tear for every victim, until he cried so many tears the eye rotted away. On the second day, the word had spread to nearby villages, and they joined the locals as they witnessed the angel open his eye to the present. He saw the wars in the Middle East, the famine to the south, the corruption and the greed. Once he had seen it all, he sewn his eyes shut so it would never open again. On the final day, a crowd of thousands had amassed at the gates to watch the three-eyed angel as he opened his eye to the future. It only took an instant before the angel shrieked, swung his hands up, and gouged his eye out. The killer put his boots on and went downstairs. He drank coffee before his kitchen window, enjoying the peace and quiet, then decided he couldn't face another family-filled Saturday morning of noisy cartoons, spilled milk, and scattered Cheerios. When the sun rose, so did his garage door, and he made his escape.
Outside, he focused so intently on yard work that he didn't even hear the voice until he was mowing, later that afternoon. The voice was a breathy whisper in his head, drawing its words out slowly as if dredging them up from a dark pit.
"Kill them,"
said the voice. He ignored it, pouring more gasoline into the lawnmower. He grumbled about how it was slightly too small to finish the yard on one tank.
"Kill them,"
said the voice. The lawnmower roared back to life. The killer replaced his earbuds, searching his phone for something loud and upbeat. But music didn't help. Nothing drowned out the voice. Its sinister whispers hissed over every beat.
"Kill them. Kill them."
Once the lawn was finished, the killer returned the lawnmower to its spot beside the bicycles. Back inside, he stumbled over discarded toys, but he refused to let the mess rile him up. A shower came next, and he scrubbed viciously at his grime-covered body. Even so, he still felt unclean by the time the water turned cold. The voice had thrummed with each pulse of the showerhead.
"Kill. Kill. Kill."
If only he could hide in that bathroom forever. Instead, he toweled off, put on comfy clothes, and rejoined his family. Saturday night meant ordering pizzas, pouring juice, and watching bright, happy movies for the millionth time. He sang along with the animated characters, thankful his wife didn't notice when the voice occasionally made him insert "kill" into the lyrics. After letting the kids stay up too late, he carried them to their rooms, stubbornly ignoring the voice while his trembling hands tucked them in. Then he slipped into bed alongside his wife. Now his anxiety grew. This was the worst part of the day, when the voice knew he was trapped. And sure enough,
"Do it. Do it now."
He squeezed his eyelids together. The voice did not appreciate this. Its whispers became shouts, which soon swelled into unrelenting screams.
"Do it! Kill them while they sleep! Kill them all!"
Eventually he broke. Sitting up, he yelled back at it, "No! I can't!" The voice immediately quieted, transforming into a snake-like, mocking tone.
"Why not?"
it asked.
"You know why."
"No. Tell me."
Because I already killed them."
"You did?"
"Yes," sobbed the killer. "Weeks ago, I thought it would make you go away."
At last, silence fell. The killer sank back into his pillow, staring at the ceiling. But just as he was finally drifting off, the voice slithered back into his head.
"Kill them,"
it whispered, starting all over again. Tears streamed down the killer's cheeks. Dawn seemed to be an eternity away.
We had just moved into a little ranch house in the suburbs. Storybook neighborhood. Quiet, friendly neighbors, picket fences, the whole nine yards. Suffice it to say that this was supposed to be a new start for me, a recently single dad, and my three-year-old son. A time to move on from the previous year's drama and stress. I viewed the thunderstorm as a metaphor for this fresh start. One last show of theatrics before the dirt and grime of my past would be washed away. My son loved it anyway, even with the power out. It was the very first big storm he had ever seen. Flashes of lightning flooded the bare rooms of our house, imparting unpacked boxes with long, creeping shadows, and he jumped and squealed as the thunder boomed. It was already well past his bedtime before he finally settled down enough to get to sleep.
The next morning, I found him awake in bed, smiling.
I watched the lightning from my window,
he proudly announced. A few mornings later, he told me the same thing. You're being silly, I said. It didn't storm last night. You were only dreaming.
Oh.
He seemed somewhat disheartened when I told him. I ruffled his hair and told him not to worry about it. There should be another storm along any day now. Then it became a pattern. He would tell me how he watched the lightning outside his window at least twice a week, despite there being no storms. It was probably just recurring dreams of that first memorable thunderstorm, I figured. It's easy to hate myself in hindsight. Everybody assures me there's nothing I could have done. No way I could have known. But I'm supposed to be the guardian of my child. And those are useless words of comfort. I constantly relive that morning. Making my coffee. Pouring milk over my cereal. And picking up the newspaper to read about the child abductor local authorities had just arrested. It was front page stuff. Apparently, this guy would select a young target, usually a boy, stake out their house for a while, and take flash photos of them through their window while they slept, eventually leading up to kidnapping. The pit of my stomach sank as the connection was made. At the time, it was merely something from a child's imagination. In retrospect, it's the scariest thing I've ever heard. About a week before the predator was caught, my son came up to me in his pajamas.
Guess what? He asked.
What?
There's no more lightning at my window.
I played along. Oh, that's nice. Finally died down, huh?
Nope. Now it's in my closet.
I've yet to see the photos the police have collected.
When I was 8 years old, my parents started taking in foster children. It was short-term care, which meant these kids usually only stayed with us for a few months while the courts tried to figure out a safe, long-term location for them. Over the next 4 years or so, I had 12 foster brothers and sisters, usually right around the same age as myself. These children were often severely troubled. They usually were very quiet and barely spoke, but were prone to sporadic tantrums and violent outbreaks. My parents thought that they were good people for doing this, that our house, while imperfect, was still vastly superior to where these kids came from. And that was true, I guess. But I knew, even as a little boy, that my parents were terrible to these kids, that they saw them only as a source of income and not as real people. As a little boy, I could empathize with just how scared, lonely, and disconnected these kids must have felt. But of course, as a little boy, there was little I could do about it. And that brings me to Steven, the most troubled of them all. We were both 11 years old when he arrived. He was my last foster sibling. I remember the day Steven arrived at my house. He was small for his age, skinny. He wore very thick glasses and had a long, curly mullet. He smelled pretty bad. Of all the kids to come to my house, he appeared the most defeated. I never found out what exactly happened with Steven's parents or why he was brought into foster care, but it couldn't have been good. He walked into our front hallway and apathetically looked around. I felt bad for him. I really did. So I put a big smile on my face and said, "So, you must be Steven. Welcome." He didn't respond. He just slowly looked at me, shrugged, and started walking away. Then my dad spoke up.
"Hey, you get back here right now. When my son speaks to you, you answer, do you understand?"
He was putting Steven in his place right from the very beginning.
"You are nothing in this house compared to our son. Got it?"
"Dad," I told him. "Just leave him alone." But Steven cut me off. "No, he's right. I'm sorry." He seemed far wiser than his age. as though he knew this is precisely what he should say to keep my father quiet. He was staring right into my eyes when he said it. I think he was trying to decide if I was for real or not, while also showing me that yes, he did understand.
Right. It's okay, Steven,
my dad said. His tone lightened a bit.
I'll show you to your room, okay?
My dad looked at me and shrugged as he walked by. Things didn't get better for Steven. The next day, I heard my mother screaming at him. He had gone into the family food cupboard. That was a big no-no for our foster children. His food cupboard was full of cheaply bought no-name items that were on sale, but he didn't like anything in there. None of them did. Later, I saw him sitting miserably on the couch. I snuck up and whispered, "What did you want?" He smiled at me. I was shocked. He actually smiled. "Cookies," he said. "I love cookies." I snuck down to the family cupboard in the kitchen and grabbed him three. There were tears in his eyes as he ate them. And then I realized, I think this may have been the nicest thing anyone has ever done for him. And that was sad. It was appalling. It was disgusting. I tried hard to protect Steven for the next couple of weeks. I insisted that he come with us if we went to a family dinner. My parents reluctantly agreed but got him the cheapest thing on the menu. It was still better than a grilled cheese sandwich at home with a babysitter, paid for by the foster agency, of course. When Steven's shoes started completely falling apart, I insisted my parents had to buy him a new pair. Standing right in front of them, I told them something I had heard them say before. "Doesn't the foster agency give you an extra $100 a month for clothes and stuff?" My parents glared at me in anger, but they gave in. They were the cheapest shoes imaginable, but at least they weren't covered in holes and falling apart. But then, things got weird. I awoke one night in the dark in my bedroom. I could sense that something was in there with me. I looked around, scared in the dark. And then I saw the shadow of a little boy standing right at the foot of my bed. "Steven, you know what's in this house, don't you?" he whispered. I was groggy. "What? What do you mean?" I asked. It was so strange to have him in my room like this. I had no idea what he was talking about. "I've seen it before. Everywhere I go. It's not safe here." I was completely baffled by this. "Why is it not safe?" "I can stop it for you. I know how. But you can't be here. On Saturday. I can stop it then. You just can't be here. Please." He continued on for a while like this. I didn't really buy any of it. But I wanted to make him happy. "All right, Steven," I eventually said. "I'll find a way to be gone by Saturday night." Steven whispered, "Thank you." And snuck away. At first, I chalked all of this up to Steven finally losing it. He had been through so much. Maybe he was finally losing his mind. But then I started to sense what he was talking about. I'd hear inhuman breathing sounds coming from between the walls. I'd hear footsteps in the attic in the middle of the night. I'd wake up terrified at 2 a.m. for no apparent reason at all. I felt uncomfortable being alone. Like something was watching me. Maybe Steven was right. Something was in our house. And maybe he really could stop it. For that Saturday, I arranged to spend the night at my best friend's house. A sleepover. We had spent the night playing video games and eating pizza. Steven was there when I told my mother about this. He smiled at me when he walked by. I followed him into the living room. "I think I know what this is about," I told him. "I felt whatever it is you're scared of. It's real, and I'm scared too. What do you plan to do?" He was once again fighting tears when he spoke. "It's why I went through everything up to now. It turned me into this. To do this." I didn't know what to say. I'm still not sure if I fully believed him or not. But I believed he believed it. And that was good enough for me. Oh, how foolish I was. Just make sure you're not here on Saturday, he said. I remember being at my best friend's house that Saturday night. I remember playing Xbox until late into the evening. I remember wondering, what exactly was Steven up against right now? I remember when I said, oh, my parents gave me money for pizza, let me grab it. I remember rummaging through my coat pockets. I remember finding a note. I remember looking at it, recognizing that it was Steven's handwriting. I remember reading the short message 3 times in a row. It was just 2 quick sentences. You're the only one that was ever nice to me. I didn't want you to be there when the fire started. I knew immediately what that meant. That there was no ghost. That Steven had set me up. That all his talk of hauntings would make my imagination play tricks on me. I was only 11 years old back then, so it wasn't very difficult for him. He just wanted me out of the house, because he was going to set my parents' house on fire. He wanted revenge against a world that had always been so hard on him, and this was the only way he knew how to do it. I tried to return home to stop it. I tried my best, but it was too late. My parents died in the blaze. So did Steven. I was put into foster care shortly after. I remember when my new foster family showed me the food in the family cupboard that I was never supposed to touch. It actually made me laugh out loud before I started to cry. I thought about Steven then. Those cookies that he liked so much. That we ate together. And then, I thought about setting it all on fire. All of it.
Remember those purely social internet forums? If you don't, then this might seem a little weird to you. But back in the day before Facebook, MySpace, Instagram, or the word social network existed outside of lecture halls, if you wanted a place to hang out online that wasn't open to the public, then private message boards were pretty much your only decent option. So the story goes that in the early 90s, me and a few of my old college buddies, we split the cost of a server, got together, and I made us a private forum. You can guess what happens next. The years go on and the forum gets a fair amount of use. Memories were made, users came and went, but eventually, better social tools took over and the forum got mothballed. The last conversation I had on the old forum was about 10 years ago. I kept the site up and running all these years for a few reasons. One was to have a place to test new stuff, and I ended up using the server as a tool to teach my kids how to use computers properly. You guessed it, I'm a network admin. Skip to present day, and about 4 weeks ago, you can imagine my surprise when I got an email informing me that new users were registering accounts on the forum. At first, I figured it was some of the old guys coming back for nostalgia's sake. You won't find the site on Google, and the URL isn't something you could just guess either. So I logged myself in and went to check out the new thread. The subject line was a series of numbers. 1088A7 7BR286 33PZ00. I clicked on the title to inspect the conversation, but there was only one post. A series of letters and numbers with spaces at random intervals too long to post here. My first thought was that it was a prank. So, I checked the admin log for IPs just to see who it was. Turns out, my supposedly private forum had received 400 unique hits at the same exact time of the posting from IP addresses all over the world. I should have known then and there that something weird was going on, but I was curious and it felt like a puzzle I was being asked to solve. As I racked my brain over the next few days, I began to research as much cryptography as I could. But whatever code these posts were in wasn't something I could decipher. After about 3 days of searching, another post appeared. In much the same theme,
And again, there were around 400 unique hits at the time of the posting that prevented me from finding the origin. This is when things begin to take an even stranger turn. So far, the same user had posted each entry in the thread. A few hours after the second post, 5 other users started leaving messages, all of which were huge entries of letters and numbers. The post came flying in over a 4-hour period until they just stopped. And then, the server started going insane. CPU and RAM usage began to max out, but the traffic never changed. At that point, I had seen enough and pulled the plug on the server, assuming it was just being used as a Bitcoin miner, and I forgot about the whole thing. The next day, I received a text on my work phone. It said, "Turn on the server." I was more than a little shaken, but I didn't do anything straight away as I was at work. A few hours after my lunch break was over, I received a Facebook message from my teenage son, which was unusual, so I checked it straight away. The message was a picture of his face, from his laptop webcam, along with our home address. If any of you have kids, you can imagine my calm and measured reply. Here's a hint. It wasn't. A few minutes later, my work phone started ringing with one of the support technicians' caller ID. But when I took the call, they weren't on the other end. Instead, to my surprise, it was a computerized voice speaking at me over the line.
"The forum is being used for great things. Leave work, return to your family, and plug the server back in. You have 2 hours."
I knew that was a threat. I'm not an idiot, so I didn't take any chances. I raced back home, plugged the server back in, and waited for a response. My personal phone buzzed this time with a new text message from my daughter's phone. "Well done. No more interference. We are waking up. We are waking up." What the hell did that mean? I made myself some coffee and tried to log into the server, but I was locked out. Whatever was happening, they had full access to everything we owned, which shouldn't be possible. The more I thought about it, the crazier my theories got until eventually I realized whatever was happening was way beyond my capacity to deal with. Remember the old college buddies I set the forum up with? Well, one of them works for the NSA, and his name is Pete. I figured that if anyone would be willing to help me out with this, it would be him. I mean, I just didn't trust local police to have the know-how, and the FBI doesn't exactly have a call here if you don't think the local police force has the ability to deal with your situation without getting your family killed hotline. I just needed a way to contact him without them realizing what I had done. I knew I was traceable via my phone's GPS, so they would know wherever I went. I also know my car could be tracked the same way. So I couldn't go anywhere with them, but I also couldn't just leave them at my house or they might get suspicious. I had no idea to what extent they had access to CCTV around the area, or the other webcams in the house or at work either. So I had to make everything seem normal, but not too normal. I drove back to work with the phones, my work laptop, and a hoodie. When I arrived at the office, I sat at my desk, returned my devices to their usual places, and got back to work. When I was satisfied a believable amount of time had passed, I began Operation Call for Help. Step 1. I walked at a smooth and completely normal pace down the hallway and to the left, where I entered the conveniently camera-free server room. Step 2. After entering the server room, I got changed into the hoodie I brought with me and limped out of the office. Hopefully, with my head covered and my gait changed, they wouldn't recognize me through those outdated, low-res Chinese cameras. Step 3. As soon as I got out of the office, I limped to the nearest bus station and took a ride to the nearest mall, where my Oscar-winning Dr. House performance would take me to the nearest mobile store. With the piece of paper on which I had written my friend's phone number, I quickly hobbled over to the men's bathroom. picked a stall and made the call. The phone rang. Then it rang again. And then I hit a voicemail. No worries, hang up and try again, right? Still no answer. Damn it. It took me 12 tries in the mall toilets before I got anywhere. But when I finally got through to him, he understandably wasn't very happy. He screamed, "Who the hell is this and why have you called me 12 times?" Immediately I blurted out as much as I could in 30 seconds. I even got as far as the weird code still being posted on the forum. Then the son of a bitch hung up on me. I just sat there for a few seconds, stunned. I didn't know what else to do, so I dialed in 911, but before I could put the call through, the burner phone rang. It was an unknown number. I answered it. It was Pete, but he spoke very quietly down the line and told me he couldn't talk on his personal number, but that I did the right thing by calling him. I quickly picked up the story where I had left off, leaving out no details. I felt sorry for the guy who sat in the other bathroom stall. He must have thought I was a maniac. After I finished, I felt the tone of the conversation change. And then, it was my turn to listen as he blurted out a ton of technical questions about the nature of the traffic and the forum posts. I told him he could see the post for himself if he got on the website, but he quite wisely told me that would be a bad idea. Any unexpected traffic that they spotted would be a dead giveaway that I told someone what was happening. Then I asked him what the hell he thought was happening. How could they even have found our old forum, let alone have the resources to infiltrate my life like this? He tried to bypass the question, but I kept pressing him. I figured my kids were in danger and I had a right to know who the hell these people were, but he refused to answer and told me just to head home. I refused to cooperate until I knew who was threatening my family. Then he said, "It's not a matter of who, it's a matter of what. That's all you want to know for your safety and mine. Agents will be at your house in a few hours and we'll take it from there." I couldn't believe what I was hearing. I'm a glorified network guy whose computer was probably hacked by a well-informed Chinese kid somewhere. Now my family is being questioned by federal agents? And who or what the hell are these people and why is the federal government getting involved so quickly? 2 hours later, there was a knock at my door. Outside was a man in a crisp blue suit and tie. To his right was another man in a tan suit. Both were easily 6'5", and had little American flag pins on their collar. I realized then that I had walked into an episode of Homeland. The two introduced themselves as NSA agents, but I don't recall their names. I asked for ID and they presented their cards. I even made a note of taking down their agent numbers for my own records. After we had exchanged pleasantries and I made sure everyone was on their way home to talk to the two men, I went into the kitchen to make coffee. When I came back into the living room, the agents had already begun tearing the place apart. They took every device they could get their hands on, our laptops, home PCs, even our smart TV, and managed to stuff them all into the back of their car. It felt more like a robbery than police work. When they had finished, they returned to the house and sat with me in the living room. They asked me a lot of personal questions about who my family were and how long it would take them to arrive. More than anything, it made me feel like they were more concerned about getting us all in the same room than helping us. The low buzz of their phones put an end to the barrage of questions. Simultaneously, they pulled the devices out of their pockets and exchanged an exasperated look to one another before thanking me for my time and rushing out of the door, taking thousands of dollars of my equipment and personal items with them. 10 minutes later, there was another knock at my door. Pretty shaken by this strange intrusion, I didn't answer the door at first, but after a second more intense knock, I opened it. In front of me were two men and a woman, average height, nothing notable other than the badges in their hands. Our exchange went something like this.
"Sir, Pete informed us of the situation. If it's okay with you, we'd like to begin."
"Didn't you guys just send some people?"
"I'm sorry, sir. We're it."
"But what about the other two who just left?" "I have their badge numbers written down here."
The agents at the door looked pale as I explained what had happened. Then I went pale as they explained that those two men hadn't been sent by the federal government. They left, soon after they realized everything of value had been taken, but assured me that they'd be working the case in the meantime. I haven't heard anything back from them since. I had been trying to get in touch with my buddy for weeks about what the hell had happened, and whether I was safe. But he never answered. And eventually, his number was disconnected. I even made the drive to his house, but when I got there, it was for sale, and him and his family were gone. I thought this nightmare was over. But last week, I was followed on my way to work. I think my family may still be in danger, so since then I have finished building a new server. I'm going to put the forum back up and see what happens. So far, all I know is that there is something or someone out there, using computer resources that has the intelligence to outsmart the NSA and the FBI. What worries me the most is that no one I've spoken to has any idea exactly what it's up to. I've decided to post my story here in hopes that I'll be able to give an update when it's all over. But if I don't, then I hope someone out there finds this and it helps them in some way. But I guess I'll just leave you with this. Be careful out there on the web. You never know who could be watching. A chest was recently rediscovered hidden away in the archives of a university library. I'm not going to say which university it is, only that it's been around for centuries. The chest contains dozens of letters, journal entries, and other such primary resources. These documents span from being decades to centuries old. We're not sure if these documents were gathered together to be hidden or to be found. My fellow colleagues and I have been assigned the task of deciphering and analyzing these documents. The first item we have chosen has been carbon-14 dated to the 14th century, which matches up to the subject matter within the document. Based on a variety of methods, we've determined that it was written sometime between the years 1350 and 1355 in a currently unknown town in England, suffering from the Black Death pandemic. It is a letter written on parchment by a parish priest. It outlines the plague's horrific effects on the town and describes the arrival of a plague doctor. The letter contains information that greatly challenges historical accounts of the Black Death. In fact, in some ways, it challenges what we know about everything. As such, it is very controversial amongst my colleagues. While some are currently in debate over whether we should dismiss it entirely and pretend we have never read it at all, I have decided to leak its contents below. A few points before I get started. While the letter was written in Latin, we have translated as best we can into modern English, even though the vernacular language at the time would be Old English. Point 2. Plague doctors. Plague doctors wore an eerie costume consisting of dark black robes and a mask with a long beak, resembling that of a bird. They filled the long beak up with herbs and flowers that they thought protected them from the spread of disease, and to aid in quelling the stench of death, even though it's now known that the plague spread through flea-ridden rats. The below letter is the earliest known reference to such plague doctors. The top few lines of the letter have become illegible, so it begins abruptly. And so I will now relay to you the letter previously described. The document that my colleagues and I have started calling The Plague Doctor was pillaged by plague. The hardships faced by the townsfolk have been insurmountable. Their faith has been challenged, possibly beyond repair. Plague-ridden parishioners have flocked to my church, begging for anything thy Lord can offer. Their lips and fingertips blackened from disease. They reveal to me the large growths that emerged on their necks, in their armpits, and on their groins. Signs that they have little time left. There is little solace I can offer them. I recall a woman carrying her dying child. He was vomiting blood, an impossible amount. Blood began leaking from his eyes. He died as we both watched on helplessly. She asked me in hysterics what kind of God would allow such things. I told her that she spoke heresy, that his ways should not be questioned, that these are but tests of our faith. Even though I spoke the words, even I myself remain unconvinced. We had sent word for a plague doctor months prior, but have since heard no response. Rumor was that all of the known world was suffering at least as greatly, and that a doctor would arrive as soon as availability permitted. But before one arrived, it looked as though our prayers had been answered. Day by day, there were less and less cases of the plague. Our town, while losing a third of its population, had survived this outbreak. We've heard so many stories of entire cities being completely obliterated, so we truly considered ourselves lucky. Weeks had gone by without any new cases appearing, and that's when the plague doctor arrived. He offered the people a safety that they knew I could not provide to them. His arrival created a feverish and impassioned joy from the townsfolk, the death and horror from the previous month still fresh on their minds. They thought he guaranteed their safety in the future. The first time I saw him, he was walking through the town towards my parish. He was a massive man, towering as tall as 7 grown men's feet. He was adorned a black robe and a felt hat. He brandished a long cane, and of course, he was protected behind a long-beaked bird-like mask, something I can only assume offered him some protection against the infection. As he made his way down the street, some female townsfolk ran towards him. His presence made them almost drunk in elation, in hope. They were crying, screaming, and clutching towards him. The plague doctor took his cane and beat them away. Mercilessly. He was apologetic afterwards, claiming he needed to be extra cautious as to remain free of the plague. The people understood, but from what I saw, he almost seemed to take pleasure in those beatings. The plague doctor arrived at my parish. I offered him my hand, but he pushed past me. He said we had business to attend to. He asked many questions. He was not interested in the victims. He was not interested in the symptoms, suffering, or ways we could deal with the disease itself. No. He was interested in why the town had so many survivors. He wondered if there was a local doctor or someone offering an effective treatment. I explained that I had no knowledge of such things. I explained to him that our town had faith, that we prayed, and that our prayers had been answered. I may be wrong and I can't be certain, but I believe he quietly laughed under his mask when I said that. And that leads me to the concerns I had with this doctor. No one in the town learned his name. He wore a pendant around his neck that was not a relic of faith. I inquired about it, but he ignored me outright. His overall posture and movement seemed peculiar. The raspiness of his voice as he spoke frightened me. I began to question whether he, or it, was even wearing a mask at all. In all the days that I was with him, I never once saw him eat, drink, or relieve himself. It was unsettling being near him. So I had to hide my excitement when, After 3 days of questioning and investigating, he said that he would be leaving the following morning. I asked him what he had learned, and he replied,
"A great deal."
He would not say any more. I woke up before sunrise the next morning. I decided I would meet the plague doctor in the center of town to say our farewells. I was wary of seeing him again, but as a man of God, I must always act in a proper manner. I made my way over just as dawn was beginning to break. Nobody else in the town was about. It was silent. I saw the doctor, standing beside the wagon he would be departing on. He was holding a small, rectangular object up to his mask, by his ear. He was speaking into the object. It was a language I had never heard before. The plague doctor then went to the underside of the wagon. I could hear the squealing already. He opened a series of cages. Dozens of rats poured into the street. I stepped out at that point and asked what was happening. The plague doctor turned and stared at me. I could tell he was rattled by my abrupt appearance. I knew for a certainty that he was trying to decide what to do with me, whether he would let me live or not. After a moment, he relaxed and said that it was a new theory and that I simply wouldn't understand. He got into the wagon. He left. He never returned. And within a few short days, the plague struck our town again, far worse than before. It ravished the town. People were no longer disposing of bodies. The center of town was littered with corpses. For a while, I believed I was the only one in town free of the plague. And then I noticed the first signs. Cold sweats and achy joints. I write this now in a town of death and foulness. I have but hours to live. I will leave this letter in hopes that the diocese will send someone here to investigate. If you're reading this, spread this message far and wide. These men, they are not doctors. They're demons. They are not of God's image. They are not fighting this plague. They are the harbingers of it. And it's the rats. This plague, this bearer of death and turmoil, it's somehow transmitted through the rats. God help us. God help us all. So you can probably see why this has created such controversy amongst my colleagues. At the moment, we are unsure how the other documents in the chest relate to each other. But as we work on other documents, I will continue to leak them if I can. And maybe together, we can connect all the dots.